Our last speaker today is Daniel Kamenovich from the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, and he will talk about the realization space of the cube. Please, Daniel.
Thank you, Angela, and thanks to the organizer of this FIPSAC online, which is great so far, for the opportunity to speak here and for everything that you're doing besides the talks. So today I want to tell you about this basic result on the geometry of the cube and some of its applications to the geometry and combinatorics of cubical polytopes. So let's start from the beginning, from the basics. So a polytope in its H representation can be given as a set of points satisfying a set of linear inequalities. And this is a D polytope if it's full dimensional, if its affine span is the RD. And if we denote by R1 up to Rm the rows of this matrix, then these are precisely the outer facet normals to this to the facets of this polytope. And then if you define the polar polytope, so the polar polytope, P triangle, is a polytope defined by taking all the points which have inner product less than or equal to 1 for every point in P, then this polar polytope is the convex hull of the points of the vertices P1 up to PM. These are the normalized facet normals, right? So you take the facet normals and you normalize by the 1 over the set of the scalars in the B vector. As an example, so if this is your polytope P, it's defined by this set of inequalities. So the first coordinate is between -1 and 2. The second coordinate is between -1 and 1. And then the polar P triangle would be the convex hull of these 4 points. So this is the normalized outer normal vector to this facet. And this is the one for this facet, etc. And for each polytope, we also define the realization space of the polytope. This is the set of all coordinatizations of this polytope of the polytope of the, with this combinatorial type. That is, all n tuples of vectors in RD such that the convex hull of these points gives you a polytope which is combinatorially equivalent to P. So combinatorially equivalent just means has the same face lattice, right? So, for example, here are two elements from the realization space of the three-dimensional cube. So this is kind of the standard cube, and this is a different deformed cube. But so this is these are two elements from the realization space of the cube, and this is what we want to study. And to study this, we want to consider transformations that act on the realization space, meaning transformations that preserve the combinatorial type. And the first type of such transformations are projective transformations. So I'll give you two descriptions of these projective transformations. One is more geometric, and this a second more algebraic. So if you have a polytope in RD, you can embed it into an affine hyperplane in RD plus 1, for example, in the hyperplane with last coordinate equals 1, and then take a cone over this, over your polytope, for example, with apex at the origin. And then you intersect this cone with another, with a different hyperplane, admissible hyperplane. So admissible means that you have to cut all the rays. And then you map it back to RD. What you get is a polytope that has the same combinatorial type as the one that you started with, but it has a different shape. It is projectively equivalent to it, but so this is a geometric way to view projective transformations. An algebraic way is to consider the map from RD to RD that takes every point to the point A times X plus B over C times X plus alpha, with A being a D by D matrix B and C being vectors in RD and alpha being a scalar, and you want that this D plus one times D plus one matrix has determined as non-negative as non-vanishing determinant. This is another way to define projective transformations, and then two polytopes are called projectively equivalent if there's a projective transformation that takes one to the other. This is the first type of transformations that we want to consider. And maybe one way to use projective transformations and one fundamental construction that uses them is the connected sum construction. And this is the following construction. You want to take two polytopes and you want to glue them along a facet in such a way that you produce a new polytope. So to produce a new polytope which has the faces of both of the polytopes except the face that you glued on. And you can do it geometrically if the facet you want to glue on are projectively equivalent. So here's an example. You have the polytope P with facet F1 and the polytope Q with facet F2. So this lemma says that if F1 and F2 are projectively equivalent, then you can form the connected sum. That is, you can glue them together to get a polytope. I mean, what you need here is a convexity, right? Convexity is what is preserved. And the proof of this lemma is kind of basic, and what you basically do is you make this polytope, you make the facet F2, the largest facet in this polytope in such a way that when you glue it, and of course to have the correct shape as F1 and in such a way, and then when you glue it, you get a convex polytope. So it follows from the fact that any two simplices are projectively equivalent that if you have any two simplicial polytopes, you can form their connected sum, because you can take any facet of the first one, any facet of the second one, they are projectively equivalent, and then you can use this gluing lemma to form their connected sum. But for the cubes, this is false already for I equals three. So these two examples that I showed you before, they are two realizations of the three-dimensional cube. These two realizations are not projectively equivalent. And therefore, you have four-dimensional cubical polytopes which you cannot glue together to have a connected sum. And so in general, you cannot do connected sum of cubical polytopes, but don't lose hope. We will have something analogous to a connected sum. We'll have a construction which is almost a connected sum. For that, we need another notion of equivalence or another type of transformation. So two D polytopes, P and Q, are called normally equivalent if they, have the same combinatorial type, are combinatorially equivalent, and have the same set of outer facet normals. So you see that this polytope and this polytope are normally equivalent because this polytope is obtained from this one by taking this facet and moving it in the direction of its normal. So kind of the transformation that you are allowed to do is to move each facet in the direction of its normal while preserving the combinatorial type. You see that if I move it too far away, I will lose it. So this is not good, but I can move it as long as I keep the combinatorial type. This transformation also, if you think on the polar polytopes, we call it a ray transformation. It's just on the polar polytopes, it just allows you to move every vertex on the ray that it spans from the origin while preserving the combinatorial type. Okay, now that we have these two types of transformations, I can tell you our main theorem. So the main theorem is that any two combinatorial D cubes, while they are not projectively equivalent, they are PN equivalent. That is, you can find a sequence of projective and normal transformations that take one D cube to the other. And actually, I'll tell you the sequence of transformations that we use, and you will see this number S would be something linear in D, in the dimension. So Let me tell you about the proof of this theorem, about the sequence taking any cube Q to any other cube Q prime. I'll do it in terms of the polar polytopes. So in terms of the polar polytopes, which are cross polytopes. So P is the polar of the cube. This is a d-dimensional cross polytope. And I'll do it in this dual setting because the two types of transformation that we use have very simple meaning, geometric meaning in the polar setting. So the first type of transformation is just translating our cross polytope while keeping the origin in the interior. So this translation is really a projective transformation of the dual cube, but in terms of the cross polytope, it's just a translation while keeping the origin in interior. And what I've told you before, normal transformations of the cube are just ray transformations of the cross polytope. So here's an example. You see, instead of this point, we choose this point. And instead of this point, we choose this point on the ray, and we get a ray equivalent cross polytope. So these are the two types that we will use. And the idea of our of the proof is that we will perform a sequence of four transformations, projective followed by ray, followed by projective followed by ray, for each pair of antipodal vertices of the of this cross polytope. So we have a cross polytope has d pairs of antipodal vertices. For each pair, we perform a sequence of four steps. At the end of this sequence, so let's say what happens at the ith step when we perform this step for the ith pair of antipodal vertices, what happens is that we get a cross polytope such that all line segments except this one that we're taking care of lie on a hyperplane which is orthogonal to this one. And then what happens after we finish the d steps is we get this property for all these line segments connecting antipodal points. And this means that we got to the standard cross polytope. Let me describe this step, this sequence of four transformations more explicitly, or maybe without, instead of seeing the steps in words, let's see a picture in what happens in three dimensions. So here's just some cross polytope. The red point is the origin. The green points are the vertices. The red lines represent the rays from the origin to the vertices. And this black line is the segment connecting these two antipodal vertices V and V prime. So what we're going to do is the step for this segment. What will happen in the end of the step is that all other points, so all these four vertices, will lie on a hyperplane which is orthogonal to this line segment. So here's what we do. The first, the transformation, we shift the origin to lie on this line. After we shifted the origin here, we then push the vertex V up along the ray. This is a ray transformation. We push it up far enough so that there exists a hyperplane orthogonal to this segment connecting V and V prime, and which separates V from all other vertices, such a hyperplane. This is a ray transformation. We then move the origin to be on the same side of this hyperplane as V. This is again a projective transformation. So now we're at the situation where V and the origin lie on this side, on one side of the hyperplane, and all other vertices of our cross polytope lie on the other side of the hyperplane. And so the last transformation we do is intersect the hyperplane with this rays. This is a ray transformation. So instead of this point, we took the point on the hyperplane. Instead of this vertex, we took the vertex on the hyperplane, etc. What we ended up with is exactly what I promised you, a cross polytope for which all vertices besides V and V prime lie on a hyperplane, which is orthogonal to the segment V, V prime. We then go on, you then go on and do the same thing for the second pair and then for the third pair. And a property of this thing is that you don't ruin what you already got. And after performing the last step, you get a combinatorial decourse polytope with segments such that this property holds for each one of them. So for each segment, there's a hyperplane which is orthogonal to that segment and contains all other segments. It follows that all these segments intersect in a point and that they are pairwise orthogonal. And this really means that you got to the standard decourse polytope. Okay, so this shows you how you can get from any cross polytope to the standard cross polytope. So you do the same for the other cross polytope. You concatenate these two sequences, and then you get a sequence that starts from one cross polytope and ends up in another cross polytope. And the number of transformations we use here is, so AD minus one. This, when you concatenate these two sequences, you can save one a transformation, but it doesn't really matter. So we have 8D minus one transformations, and you take the duals to do it for the cubes you started with. As a corollary, we get that in fact, not only is this the realization space of the D cube is connected, it's in fact contractible. And the idea of the proof is that this is something I didn't tell you when I described the algorithm, but the choices that we make in each step, we make arbitrary but canonical choices. So in the first, for example, in the first step, when we move the origin to lie on the line segment connecting V and V prime, we move it to the midpoint of this line. Later, when we push V up and then take the origin to be near V and choose our hyperplane, all these choices we make them canonical, so in such a way that they depend on the geometry of the cross polytope that you have. And this means that the resulted map that you have on the realization space is really a homotopy to the point P, which represents the standard cross polytope. So really we get contractibility. Okay, here's what I promised you about the connected sum. We can then use this, in fact, this main theorem to have a connected sum. How do we do it? So given any two combinatorial D minus one cubes, we can use the main theorem to construct a D tower having bottom facet Q1 and top facet Q2. So if you have any D minus one cube and any other D minus one cube, you can kind of incarnate each of the transformations that we made into a cube, into the bottom and top facets of a cube. So if you have, and the proof of this lies in this lemma, if you have any two combinatorial D cubes which are normally equivalent or projective, so the projectively equivalent part is trivial, but if you have two cubes that are normally equivalent, then you can construct a D cube which has Q1 on its bottom and Q2 on its top, so opposite facets. How do you do it? You just realize them both, say on the last coordinate equals zero in RD, and then just take one of them to the last, to height one, and take the convex hull. What you get is a cube that has these two facets on the bottom and on the top. So you can, in this way, construct this tower. This is the proof. A few more words about the proof, but essentially is what I told you. And so if you take the steps in our main theorem and use the gluing lemma to glue these cubes one on top of the other, you will get a cubical connector. So for any two combinatorial D minus one cubes, Q and Q prime, there is a D tower of 4D cubes. So 4D is the number of normal transformations that we made, because we really don't need to waste a cube for projective transformations. You can just change the top of it. So there's a tower of 4D cubes with bottom facet Q and top facet Q prime. We call this a cubical connector and denoted by CQQ prime. And then we can have a cubical connected sum. This is the analog of the connected sum that I told you, So you take, you have a polytope Q1 with facet F1, a cubical polytope Q2 with facet F2. Then you can form the tower C F1 F2. And then you can glue Q1 to the tower using the gluing lemma because they are projectively equivalent. You can then glue Q2 to the tower on top using the gluing lemma. And then you get a polytope, which is a cubical connected sum. So it's not really a connect, it's not really a connected sum because you have this thing in the middle, but this thing in the middle is very simple. It's just a tower of 4D cubes. An application of this tower is related to a previous work that I talked about once in FIPSAC in 2018, but to cubical polytopes, where we constructed together with Ron Adin and Eran Nevo, we constructed extremal examples of cubical polytopes, and which show which told us what is the minimal closed cone that contains all the G vectors or all the Q or all the F vectors of cubical polytopes. And using this this cubical connected sum, we can really fill in the whole cone. So we can really find constructions that approach any given ray inside this ortand, and this is because the cubical G vectors are additive with respect to this construction, well, except in the first coordinate, but you see there's, if you take n to infinity, this is something constant, this doesn't really matter. And this is the theorem that we have, any ray in the non-negative orthant in R to the D over two, we can approach by, there's a sequence, there's an infinite sequence of cubical polytopes approaching any ray inside the non-negative orthant. Okay, let me finish with some problems and generalizations. First is about the optimality of our construction. So I told you that we have a sequence of 4D transformations that take us from any combinatorial cube to the standard one. Can we do better? I mean, just by dimension count, the realization space of the D cube has dimension 2D squared, and the projective linear group has D squared plus 2D. This, by the way, shows you already that for dimension at least three, there are cubes which are not projectively equivalent because this would be smaller for D at least three. But you can see that the difference is only, it might be possible that only adding a constant number of operations will generate the whole realization space. We don't know. So maybe even just three transformations, like projective, then ray, and then projective, it might be that this suffices, we don't know. This is the first thing. Second thing is finding more families that that are PN unique. That is that the realizations, more polytopes that are PN unique, that the realization space is at least connected with respect to these two types of transformations. So we call a combinatorial type of a polytope PN unique if any two realizations are connected by a sequence of normal and projective transformations. The dual notion, so we call it PR unique, so a projective and ray transformations. But for the dual notion, you need to be slightly careful and to ask that you're allowed to do projective transformations and ray transformations, but you're not allowed, you're not allowing the origin to leave the interior. So the origin must be in the interior of your polytope. Otherwise, in the dual, it can take facets to infinity and change the combinatorial type. So we have these two notions of PN unique polytopes and PR unique polytopes. We have proved that cubes are PN unique and dually cross polytope is PR unique. And we have some further consequences. So for example, if you have a PR unique polytope and you have a simplex, then their connected sum that is stacking on a PR unique polytopes results in a PR unique polytope. And this means, for example, that there are in every dimension, at least two, there are infinitely many combinatorial types of PR unique polytopes because there are infinitely many combinatorial types of stacked polytopes. This is in contrast for what happens with projectively unique polytopes, because there are only finitely many in dimensions 2 and 3. This is one result. Second, or maybe I see that I'm already out of time, but let me maybe finish with this theorem. Our result about the realization space of the cube really works for any sum with of a PR unique polytope with a simplex, or really works for example, for the family of products of for any polytope which is a product of simplices, our result holds the same. So you can connect the realization space is connected by projective and ray transformations, and even the contractibility result holds, because you can do exactly the same algorithm as we did for the cube, right? The cube is just a product of one simplices, but for any product you can do exactly the same thing and this will work. And that's it. Let me finish with a question. Is a dodecahedron PN unique? I don't know. Thank you.
Thanks, Daniel, for your great talk. If you want to share your screen, we can all share our reactions. And I think there's been some questions in the chat, so I'll ask Arvind to take care of that.
Okay, thanks, Daniel. So first, Alejandro Morales asks, where is that? Yeah. What is an example of a polytope with non-contractible realization space?
I mean, I think you can find even polytopes with non-connected realization spaces. I don't have a good answer. I need to think about this.
Alex Fink maybe suggests an option, suggests a possibility. He says one could construct a four polytope by running the procedure of a paper on the archive on a non-contractible semi-algebraic set. This isn't very explicit though. I'd still like to hear if Daniel knows an explicit one.
I'm guessing there should be something explicit, maybe even dimension four, which is should be simpler, but I don't have an immediate answer here.
Okay, thank you. Joseph Doolittle asks, is it possible to save half your steps by choosing a remaining antipodal pair which already has a hyperplane separating one of those vertices from all the rest? Do you have an example where this doesn't happen for every pair?
So I'm guessing that, for example, you can see that in dimension three, you don't have to do anything for the last pair, or maybe in dimension four, you can save. So I don't know if half of them, but yeah, I'm pretty sure that you can save some of them.
Okay,
thank you. I didn't work out the details because, just having this constant number was enough for the things that we wanted. And but it's a good question. I mean, we conjecture that you really, in the end, you will only need just a constant number. You could do it with a constant number of transformations. You won't need something that depends on D.
Hmm. Okay. Vic Reiner has two questions. One, does the connectivity of the realization space of the cube show that there are not only Klee Minty cubes having possible monotone paths between two adjacent vertices, but monotone paths of any intermediate length?
I don't know how to answer that because, I don't know. I'd have to think about this.
Okay. And he, as a follow-up question, asks, do we know which Hamiltonian cycles on the cube are realizable by functionals in this way?
I'm not sure. I'd have to think about these questions. Good questions.
Okay. Stephen Lassina asks, are there polytope operations such as vertex figure, product, etc., that manifest nicely on the realization spaces?
You can see, so there's a famous book, Realization Spaces of Politics, which is really, I think, the PhD thesis of Richter Gebert, and I think you can see there. So I'm not going to give a precise answer, but yeah, some constructions you can realize then topologically. Some nice polytopal constructions give you nice topological constructions of the realization spaces, but I'm not ready to specify them.
Okay, I think that's what Vic Reiner pointed out too. Maybe the last question in the interest of time from Jiayuan Wang. Is there an algorithm to transform any combinatorial cube into the standard one using the two transformations?
What do you mean? So this is exactly what, so the proof is transforming any combinatorial cube exactly into the standard one using
the two transformations,
or using the two types of transformations?
Well, I'm just reading what he asked. I suppose he meant using two types of transformations.
So two types, this is what the proof does. So we use the two types. We have 4D transformations that take any cube to the standard cube. And they are, out of these 4D transformations, 2D are normal transformations and 2D are projective transformations.
Right. Okay. So he clarified that. That's what he wanted to know. Okay. Perfect. Thank you so much. Back to you, Angela.
Okay. So let's thank Daniel again. Thank all our speakers today. Thanks so much.